Good morning. My name is David Covey. I'm the chairman of the Texas State Republicans. Thank you for joining us today in College Station, where the young Republicans are having our board meeting. And more importantly, we're joined by three illustrious gentlemen who are running for the our next Republican Party of Texas chair. And so they're going to be talking today about what they are going to be doing if they're elected, their background, and helping you guys to know them better so you can make an informed decision with the SREC, and then again at convention next year. So without further ado, I'll turn it over first to David Covey to introduce himself.
Thank you, Hayden. My name is David Covey, and I love the intimacy here after a year of COVID. We can all sit close together and come back out of it. I'm chairman of the Orange County Republican Party, and I'm native Texan. I love Texas. I love the state. I love the opportunity that we have in Texas because of the limited government and the freedoms which so many in this room have already fought for. I started out as a young Republican volunteering as a block walker. I have become a precinct chair, county chair, moved up to state Republican executive committee man for Senate District 3. I've traveled the state just teaching county chairs how to run primary elections and serving, seeing how we work with our counties across the state and also with our auxiliary. So I'm married to my lovely wife, Esther, who's sitting back here in the back. She's really given me a lot of inspiration and just to see how important it is that as Republicans, we continue to fight the battle for our state because we want to give a better future to our children and to their children after them. So very glad to be here, glad to be a young Republican, and glad that our first forum is here with the YRs. Bill YRs, the next governor of the state that is probably sitting in this room. These are the future leaders of the party. And so it's good to be here to start this whole conversation in this room today.
Hi, everybody. I'm Matt Rinaldi. As you know, I'm a former state representative. I had the honor of serving in the Texas legislature for 4 years. I'm not a native Texan. I'm a political refugee from Connecticut. And I came to Texas because of the opportunity our political system affords me and more importantly, my children, to live free and to seek out their own way. I think it's very important, especially in this time. Over the past year, politics has probably affected the lives of every Texan more than any other year in my lifetime. We shut down society. Politics has put people out of work. Politics has affected us more intimately in schools and in our daily lives than ever before. And it's more important than ever that a strong Republican Party, because more than ever, the contrast between the parties are so stark. And that's why I'm running for state chair. I believe we need a functioning, independent, and strong Republican Party to be the voice of the grassroots going forward to present a positive view on policy, not just to oppose Democrats, but to show the way forward for a better Texas and better America.
And Representative, and last but certainly not least, Chad Wilbanks.
Hey, thank you. My Steve, or thank you. SREC members and graduates of our home, thank you. My name is Chad Wilbanks, and I'm going to be your chairman of the Republican Party of Texas. I think what you need to know about me, most importantly, is I've been married for 27 years, have 2 kids who go to college, and have 9th grade go to Lake Travis High School out in West Austin. Prior to that, I've been to every GOP state convention in Texas since 1992. One exception in 1996 when I was employed at the Republican National Committee. In 1999, we moved back to the state of Texas because we were having an 8th generation Texan. So we had to be back on our own ground to start our family. When I came back to Texas, I ended up serving as a political director, deputy executive director, and then executive director of the Republican Party of Texas. And during my time there, in 2002, we raised $17 million for the 2002 election cycle. So we elected a then record number of Republicans to the state house. The majority for the first time away from Democrats in 132 years. In 2004, we elected more Republicans to Congress in the state of Texas than we ever had before. So many that we still have more Republicans in the state of Texas than any other state in the Union. And those are Chad Wilbanks. I'm running for your state chairman of the Texas GOP.
Thank you, gentlemen. So as we go into the forum, I'll outline how it'll work so that the audience knows exactly what we're going to work through. So we have a few questions that have been submitted by Republicans, by members of this board. And those have been collected so that we can ask our candidates. Each of them will be given 2 minutes to answer each question so that we can hear from all of them on all of the issues that are most important to our members. And I'll also note, though, as a side, you're probably wondering what this thing is here, and so I'll just address that now. This is our State Federation of the Year trophy. We won that from IRS for our excellent work for the 2020 election, and my board made me have that here with me while I was talking to you, so that is why we have a trophy next to me. And now we're going to get
take advantage of it, but we need our own information.
ensure that we know what's happening. You know, that's why we vote Republican as Republicans this last cycle, so that we can control this and have a larger say for where these lines are drawn. And I do agree that we need to focus on the rural areas that are important, because we know that in Senator Ted Cruz's race, it's the rural areas that pulled that victory off. But we can't forget about the urban areas, and so we still have to invest heavily there. We still have to crunch the numbers. We still have to know where how we can serve the people of those districts the best. That takes communication. That takes data.
Thank you, David. Moving on to our second question, also related to elections. We just left a municipal election cycle for most places in Texas. Summer's coming up in November, and as we saw, the party got involved in a lot of places, and the Democratic Party as well. So how should the party counter partisan Democrats holding nonpartisan municipal offices? And Matt, we'll start with you.
Interesting question, because the Democrats have increasingly made these nonpartisan offices partisan. I think we as RPT need to work with the county chairs in identifying who the Republicans are that are running for these municipal offices and support them. I mean, we just need to do that. Because what we've seen in the suburbs and what we've seen in many of our suburban areas is the Democrats have put together a coalition with more moderate Republicans and independents to elect very, very liberal school board members, very, very liberal city council members. And we can't let that happen. The Democrats have a slight monopoly in that area. We need to do it. We can't do it top down with our RPT. We do need to communicate with our county chairs, because they're going to know the people who are involved better than anyone else. And if there's two Republicans in a race, well, you know, we probably need to help out both of them, or I need the Democrat. We might need a different approach in each race, but we need to be more involved in those races.
Thank you.
We have an effort that's been ongoing for recruiting candidates through the Leadership Institute. They've been traveling the state. I think we need to continue that, and we need to make sure that we have candidates that are trained. Everyone here needs to run for school board. We have a mayor pro tem here. We have folks that run for office. Everyone here needs to be running for office at the local level. We need conservatives in office. When it comes to these positions, we need to be recruiting the people to do it. So I agree. We do need to work with the county chairs. We've done that. And they can funnel that information up to the state level, because here's what we know. The Democrats are not going to play fair. So they're trying to influence every race and every election. And so we need to get involved in training people that can run at every level, all the way from top to mouth down to the bottom.
Thank you, David. Chad?
Well, the Republican Party, a partisan nation. So when you engage in nonpartisan races, you're pulling away resources that go towards Republican candidates. So we have to think very carefully how we want to approach that. Now, what was really exciting to see for the past, you know, 4 or 5 months is that we saw patriots all across the country stand up at their school board meetings to fight the Marxist critical race theory debacle that's going on. And so we do have to be engaged in some capacity. Now, the training aspect, as David pointed out, is certainly true. We have to have a bottom-up approach, because that's what we are as Republicans. We have a bottom-up approach in the grassroots rise. But it's going to have to be a couple things. Number one, as we pointed out earlier, it's got to have databases to make sure that the right candidates are running. Two, we have to find those that are most engaged and willing to speak up and take on the Marxist and Barrett theory that's out there right now. And so when we look at city council races, school board races, I think school boards, and talk to the Trump administration, that's where the focus is right now, because of CRT going on. But again, in order for us to support the candidates, we have to be able to raise the finances to help them get the message out there at their level. Otherwise, we have a very disorganized campaign, so there's an approach for it. So as chairman, one of the things we can do is we can put together a committee to focus on how we help nonpartisan races and where we can be the best benefit for our candidate at SRC at that level.
Thank you, Chad. David, we'll go back to you to start this one. What steps can the RPT take to better reach and grow presence among young people? How do you plan to coordinate with existing auxiliaries, such as the Texas Air Republican Federation?
You know, I think that in the YRs, we have a lot of talent. We have people that are CEOs, that are attorneys, that are doctors, that are entrepreneurs, that are elected officials. If we can room at the RPT office where you have office space to come work, to coordinate, to have open lines of communication so we can see where are you working. As was pointed out before, the YRs put on the largest Republican event in the state this past year. It was very successful. We have people, and we need to look at people based on their experience. I would rather have someone that's in their 30s that has a decade of experience versus someone that's much older, but it's their first day on the job. So let's take people and look at their experience, look at their background, look at what they've done, and then put them in the place that they can best serve to keep Texas red.
Thank you, David. Chad?
Well, I've been very fortunate. I got involved in politics at a very young age. I started off being supervisor president in high school, and then became chair of the public at St. Edward's University, and then chair of the Human Services of Texas. So before I really had a chance to go to the YRs, I ended up working for the Republican National Committee. So I've been doing this for a living. And when I came back to state of Texas, I sat down with my boss at the time, and the chairman said, I would like to do this. And this was from a campaign school for young students to help candidates win. Because they needed to be athletes. Pretty good candidates running in 1998, 2000, but we still haven't won the whole Texas House. So let's train these young folks. And so one thing we did in our campaign school was fantastic. But they went for 6 days, went 18 hours a day, we had homework every night, and the last day to present your campaign plan to win. And some of these people that have come through our course, when we did this in 2000, went off to be senior advisor to Ted Cruz. We had a local communications director for several U.S. senators. We had others that worked in D.C. We had another that's doing state house races and congressional campaigns all over the country. We had some of the chief staffs, so because they had registered the house, we had chief staffs from agencies or chairman's agencies. So the best part was watching them get involved early and watching them rise up to the ranks of their own children to have these really successful jobs. It's so refreshing and rewarding. The first thing we had to do is we had to ask and find plans to engage the young folks to be involved. Whether it's at a 20-year-old or a 30-year-old, because there's different experiences for both. I'm going to echo a little bit what David said. Get in and run for the school board race. Run for city council. This is the farm team of the future of the Republican Party of Texas. We have to be engaged.
Matt.
So here's the question was, how do you reach out more to young people and how are you going to work with the young Republicans and other groups? How are you going to work with the young Republicans and other groups? It's about delegation and communication. I think we need to keep an open line of communication. We have resources here that are going to be very important in get-out-the-vote efforts, in ID candidates, hunting new candidates for local races and state races. And I think we need to do that and work together these great organizations in order to do that. And how do you reach out more to young voters? Look at what appealed to new and younger voters in the past. I mean, I'm a little older, so not as old as Chad.
But
I'm a little older than David. And I'm in between. No, if you look like the 80s, the big movement that brought people in was, Phil Graham brought so many more people into the movement that then became staffers. Certainly other people later on. Then, when in the 90s, was the Contract with America, when we took the Congress for the first time since the 1940s. And that brought people in. And then you had in the 2000s, the Ron Paul movement brought people in, who then worked for candidates like Ted Cruz and other Republican candidates. Ideas bring people in at a time when we're seeking those ideas that are going to take hold 20 years in the future when younger individuals are having children. What is the world you want to build? That's the question that brings younger people into politics.
Thank you, Matt. Next question is from Chad. What kind of approach will you take to promote the party's platform and ensure legislative priorities are addressed from session or special sessions?
Great question. The Republican platform, a bunch of words on a piece of paper that identifies us as Republicans. This is the party that we support, certainly when advocated, there's four because the grassroots put these words together.
putting your points of order intentionally in the bill fail effect. I've served in the legislature for 4 years. I've served in a lot of relationships from the legislature. I think it would benefit RPT to have a former legislator as chair in terms of passing legislative priorities. Because, you know, we've often seen as two sides emerging, as they always do. One is don't pay attention to legislative priorities, only pay attention to administrative aspects so you can get along with legislative officials. And the other is push super hard and pressure on the legislative priorities. Well, what I think is, you know, it benefits someone to know what those pressure points are, where we can put targeted pressure on our legislators when there's an impediment in the bill process. I've had, for example, this past session when our priority constitutional carrier was going through, legislators would call me and say, hey, this is going to be a problem, you know, can you put a little pressure on this person, put a little pressure on that person. And those sorts of relationships are important. Because they would say things to me that they wouldn't say to somebody who they hadn't served with before in conflicts. And I think it's important to have a chair who not only can work with the legislature, but knows those pressure points, knows them well, and knows the legislators well, and also is willing to put targeted pressure to achieve a particular goal in the Republican Party.
Matt, David?
You know, the delegates can work really hard on getting those. And I think that the chair needs to be able to come out strongly when it's needed publicly and talk about election integrity and talk about issues like gender modification, which is nothing less than child abuse. We need to be strong on the issues. But here's what we do. We're not a name caller. We're not a no-vote. What we are is we act like more of a sniper. We pick our targets. We make sure we're going to hit the target. There's not collateral damage. And then we take our shot. We're not just a grenade tosser, right? That will sometimes come back to bite us. So let's make sure we have an approach. Let's make sure we're focused in putting pressure on legislators. But we need to make sure that we're actually standing strong for the delegates, that we fight for their values, that we take a stand on the fiscal issues, but also on the social issues, because those are important to our delegates, and those are what will bring people out to the polls.
David, Matt, back to you.
Yes.
Earlier, Chad mentioned fundraising and the mother's milk politics, and so, what do you believe is the target fundraising that we need in the RPT to be successful next year? And what will be your plan for raising those funds?
I mean, we need to raise $1.6 million for the convention. We need to raise at least $4 million for operations in order to keep a robust account. And I think the chair is going to be responsible for pulling in a lot of large donors as well as corporate donors as well. Chad's right, it is. One of the most important parts of running a functioning Republican Party. I have experienced fundraising. I've been successful fundraising. I've run two re-election campaigns, and in those two re-election campaigns, I was among the top fundraising state house reps in the entire state of Texas. I raised close to $1 million in my re-election campaign. I raised over $1 million, I think it was, in 2018. And that was just in a small geographical house race that didn't affect a lot of other areas in Texas. Obviously, with RPT, that gives access to a lot more broader appeal to different areas of the state. But when you ask, I'm going to mind my fundraising contacts and meet with every single large donor who's donated to my campaign in the past, as well as RPT in the past, and work every single day. Grind it out and fundraise to meet our fundraising.
Thank you,
Matt.
David?
Yeah, when you talk about the numbers, you know, you're looking at, I can do it in the actually 1.5. ready to come in, if we as a party can show that we have stability, and that we're going to be focused on growing the party and stay focused on turning it out for great.
Thank you, David. Jeff?
Well, there's several different accounts we have to fundraise. So corporate is wildly important. Here's different corporate pays for. Corporate pays for office space, pays for your staff salaries, pays for education training, pays for your veterans training, pays for convention. And so when we raised $1 million to play the global convention, we had 11,000 delegates, all visiting the guests. I'm looking at 2022, we might have 70,000. There's been a drop off the number of attendees coming up. So you probably don't need to spend as much money because you plan for 18,000 people, but less than that show up. There's ways you can reduce costs from there. But we've got to raise good money. We've got to raise a lot of money because we're the beacon of Republicans in the entire country. And our mission ought to be rah-rah instead of slugfests. We have those slugfests, let's go celebrate the growth party. So that's one faction you have, fundraising. You have another one that comes to federal dollars. And your federal dollars are very, very precious because the contribution is associated with it. So what we see in the party right now is not raising corporate dollars. They're using precious federal dollars to pay for staff, office space, lawsuits, travel, because whatever it may be. And you put your federal dollars towards elections. And then you have your state dollars. That's really the small dollar grassroots money comes in to help grow the party as well for election candidates and so forth. So overall, at the end of the day, you want to have probably somewhere between $10 to $12 million that strong, robust party can grow it. And the chair of the party is going to be focused mostly on fundraising in the very beginning stages because of the financial status of the party that we're in right now. So the chairman said probably have 50% of their time raising money. And in my opinion, the immediate need is to raise money for a convention because the party's got money for a convention. The contract's signed. We've got to raise money to make sure we're prepared to have a rah-rah session in 2022.
Thank you, Chad. And for our last question, we'll go back to David, who started. This particular election you guys are running is a new one. Your electorate is the S-RAC members, and they have a vacancy for the RPT chair. But we have an election for the body, the federal body, next year for RPT chair as well. And so the question from our members is, as a candidate for RPT chair, will you commit now to running for re-election at the next convention in 2022 and maintain that position for at least the full 3 years, this year and next two, that will be required for tenure, unless some life-changing event occurs. And members want me to make sure we clarify, running for office does not count as a life event. David?
Yes, so that's easy. I'm in this for the long haul. I'm not a celebrity. I'm not living a springboard. I'm here for the party. I've started at the beginning. I've come up in the party, and I have the experience. I'm uniquely qualified to lead the party in this next step. So I'm here, I want to see us succeed. I want to see the Republican Party not go on the defensive, but go on the offensive and make Texas redder than we ever have been before. Let's
who is the chair and who